Want to learn DaVinci Resolve and need to learn it fast? Let's go from install to export right now. So to download DaVinci Resolve, you can Google DaVinci Resolve or you can follow the link in the description, but we can go straight to Blackmagic's website where we can find DaVinci Resolve. We can scroll down on this page till we see DaVinci Resolve free download now. We can go ahead and click on that. And we want to download the one that is just the regular DaVinci Resolve, not Studio. Studio is the paid version, although you can buy it if you want. And we're going to go ahead and download the respective version for your operating system. I'm running Windows, so I'll go ahead and download that. And you can just put in your information and then hit register and download, and it'll download the software, and then you can install it from there. Now, when you first open DaVinci Resolve, you'll see this project manager, and this is where all of your project files will live. To get started, we can go ahead and double click this untitled project icon and then give it a name and then tell it where you want it to live and then hit create. And that will open DaVinci Resolve. And it'll open up on the cut page, but we're going to spend our entire time on the edit page today, just to get started with how we're going to work in this. Now I'm going to select this tab right here to stretch the timeline across the screen, which is where the bulk of our work happens. Now the first thing we want to do is actually import our footage. So let's go ahead and go into the folder that we have our footage in. And I've got a folder of B-roll and music here. So I can just highlight both folders and then just drag and drop them into Resolve. And it's going to ask me if I want to change my project frame rate. Sometimes it'll do this if the project is set to a different frame rate than the footage that you're bringing in. So most of the time you will want to hit change so it matches the footage that you bring in. And you can see we have all our files imported into Resolve. Now, if I want to stay organized and create folders in here, I can just right click in this window and select new bin. And this will create a new folder. So I can just say, let's make a video folder. We'll go ahead and right click again, make another new bin, make it audio, and then I'll make another new bin just for fun, call it timelines. And now we can organize our files accordingly. So let's go ahead and just control click all our video, throw it into the video folder. We'll highlight the audio, which is a music track, throw it in audio folder, and then timelines we'll get to in a second. Now, what a timeline is it's where our story really comes together, and it's where we craft our story, and where we put all of our clips, all of the everything together. So the way that we can create one is just by simply dragging and dropping a file into the timeline window. And you'll see it automatically created a timeline for us. So we can just go ahead and drag and drop this into that timelines folder so it's separate. And now we actually have something that we can work with. So to describe how this timeline works, we have this red bar here called a playhead. And if we click and drag it, we can skim through our footage and it'll show whatever the playhead is on top of. We also have separate video and audio layers. So if I click and drag this up, you'll see it creates a new layer so we can stack things on top of each other so that we can better organize our footage. So let's go ahead and bring this clip back down to the first layer. And then to bring in the rest of them, we can just click the first one, hold shift, and click the last one, and it highlights all of our clips. And we can click and drag this into our timeline, and it'll add all four clips in sequential order. And then to scroll in and out of the timeline, you can hold alt and then scroll with your mouse wheel. If you want to move the timeline left and right, you can hold control and scroll up and down as well. Now to actually preview your video and watch it in real time, you can just go to where you want to go with the playhead, and then you can either press the space bar, which will just play, or press the space bar again to pause it, or you can use the J, K, and L shortcuts. J goes in reverse, K pauses, and L goes forward. And if you press L multiple times, it'll double the speed each press, which can be really useful when trying to preview your timeline or clips. Now, how do we actually cut our clips? Well, let's hover over the beginning of this clip, and as we do, we'll see that our icon changes, showing what clicking and dragging will do to it. We can click and drag to trim the beginning of the clip. And then if we want to do the end, we could do the same thing and just hover over this edge, and you'll see as we hover the mouse over, the icon will change based on where on the edit point we're looking at. But if we hover over this, we could bring it back like this. However, that leaves a gap, and that's not exactly what we want. So I'm going to press Control Z to undo that action. And now I'm going to go up to this icon here, which is the trim edit mode. Now what trim edit mode does is it allows us to do a ripple cut. And I'll explain what ripple means in a minute. But if we hover over this spot on the clip again, and we start clicking and dragging, it'll actually pull this clip back with us so that we don't have that gap anymore. So let's go ahead to where the end of the clip is that we want, which is probably right around here. And then we can do basically the same thing with the next clip by hovering over this point. And as we drag it to the right, we can change the beginning of the cut while pulling back everything else ahead of the timeline with it. And then if we play this back, it plays back seamlessly. And then to go back to our regular edit mode, we can just press this icon here or press V to go back to selection mode. And so I'm going to scroll ahead to the next clip. Now, again, I could hold control and scroll like this, but you can also middle click and drag for more refined movements. So I'll bring the playhead over here, and instead of using the blade tool to make a cut on the clip, I'm going to use the split clip shortcut, which by default is control or command backslash. And speaking of shortcuts, those are found up here if you go to the DaVinci Resolve keyboard customization. This is where you can customize your shortcut layout, which I definitely recommend looking into, and maybe even setting a goal of learning a new one per project when you're starting out, as they dramatically increase your workflow speed. So if I click in the search bar and type in split clip, you'll see the shortcut pop up here, which I have bound to C for cut, but you can bind it however you'd like. Now for another shortcut I'll show you, you'll type in ripple and select the trim tab, and we're going to use the ripple start and end to playhead shortcuts. The default is control shift brackets for either one. I'm gonna go back to what I have it set to right here. Now, what exactly does ripple mean? Well, let's just demonstrate that here. So we have this part of the clip that we don't wanna use. If I highlight it and press backspace, we can do a normal delete, but it leaves a gap in between. If I cut the same thing using ripple delete by pressing shift backspace, it'll close the gap automatically. So ripple basically just means closing the gap. Now let's take a look at those ripple start to playhead and ripple end to playhead shortcuts that I just showed on this next clip. So let's scooch on over here and let's find the spot where we actually want to start the clip, which is probably right around here. Now to use these other two ripple shortcuts, the ripple start to playhead will look at the start of this clip, so this edit point over here, and it'll look where the playhead is and it'll ripple cut everything in between. So if I use ripple start to playhead, it'll bring the playhead over to this previous edit point and ripple cut everything in between. And then ripple end to playhead is basically the same thing but the opposite side, so it'll bring the end of the clip or edit point to where the playhead is. Now for this next clip, we're going to go ahead and make a little trim here, do the start to playhead, and I'm just going to scroll ahead and use end to playhead. Now let's say we wanted to use a different part of this clip without actually moving anything. We can use what's called slip. If we go back to our trim edit mode by pressing T, you'll notice that when we hover over the middle of the clip, we have this icon that shows up with two brackets on either side. If we click and hold the clip, you'll see that it shows the full length of the clip, and as we move it back and forth, we can see that the viewer is showing us four different things. We're seeing what the current beginning of this clip is in the timeline, the current ending, the last frame of the previous clip, and the first frame of the next clip. And now we've just changed the part of the clip we're using without moving it in the timeline. Now I'm just going to scroll out, alt scroll, to see the rest of the timeline. Now you'll notice that we have a lot of audio in here, but it's all just scratch audio from the camera that we don't need. This is a good time to point out a couple other icons up here. So we have this snapping tool and the linked selection tool. Now what snapping does, if I scroll in here, is if I move this timeline playhead and I get to an edit point, you'll see that it kind of snaps into place as we get to the edit point. Or if I move something, you'll see it kind of locks in place a little bit as I'm moving it. That's what snapping does. If I turn snapping off and then try to move this playhead again, you'll notice it's no longer snapping to any of the edit points. Or if I move something, it's not snapping into place. So I'm just going to go ahead and undo that. I'll go ahead and turn the snapping back on. Whenever we click on a video or audio clip, it highlights both the video and audio layers. And that's because of this chain link right here, because these clips are bound together. We can just press this linked selection tool to disable that. And now, regardless of whether or not something is linked, we can select everything individually. And so let's go ahead and scroll out. And this way, we can just highlight all of our audio and delete it, because we have no use for it. And this is probably a good time to bring our music in. So let's go ahead and go up to that audio folder in our media pool And we have this forest track right here. So let's just go ahead and drag this onto the timeline. So let's go ahead and go back to this first clip here. And then once again, zoom in. And let's listen real quick to where this beat hits. So maybe I want it right on this little notch right here to start the next clip. So let's go ahead and go back into our trim edit mode, and then let's click and drag this over here. Now you'll notice that as we do that, it seems to cut both of our clips here, and that's not necessarily what we want. Undo this. If we look at these icons over here, we'll see this disable sync lock. And basically what that means is anytime we do a ripple trim of any sort, we can disable a track that we don't want to follow the ripple. So now if we click and drag this, it only ripples this top layer and it doesn't ripple the bottom with it. But having these sync locks can be really useful if you have dialogue that you're trying to keep synced with footage that's on a different place in the timeline. Now let's go ahead and move on to this next edit point. Let's cut this one right here. So we'll go ahead and once again ripple trim this end over here. Let's move on to this next edit point. This one might not necessarily need to be that long, so let's find this spot here. And I actually don't mind that as a cut point. So let's go ahead and start this clip where we want. Let's go ahead and drag this until we start to see her dance here, which is right around there. And we'll go ahead and scroll out here, and we need to cut up this last clip so it aligns with the end of the music. So let's find a good spot to cut this here. I'm just going to make a regular cut. And then if we scroll in and we go ahead and ripple trim this, we can just bring this back to wherever it aligns with the end of the music here, which is right there. We can go back into our trim edit mode and slip this and see if we can find a better spot to go right where she's going around a tree here instead. Now that cut's not as egregious, but I think I would like to add a transition instead. Now to find the transitions, we can go to the effects tab and select this icon to open up our toolbox where we can find and select our video transitions. Now there are many types of transitions, but we'll keep it simple and add in a cross dissolve. And if we play this through, now the cut is a little more seamless, implying the passage of time. So if we scroll out, we'll see we have a basic full video piece together. And just a quick shortcut, if you press the up and down arrows, those will take you to the next and previous edit points respectively. Now if we want to cut the gap at the beginning so the video starts at the beginning of the timeline, we can do it in a few ways. We can either highlight all of our clips and drag like so, or by pressing Ctrl or Command A and dragging it all back. Or we can go back to the start of the first clip and use Ripple Start to Playhead, and that'll snap it to the beginning as well. The next thing we can look at is bringing in titles or text. So in the effects tab, we'll select titles. Now in this titles tab, there are many different static and animated presets you can use, but I'll keep it simple and just use the standard text plus title here by clicking and dragging it to the timeline. And then we can select it and go to our inspector window. Now you can think of the inspector as the command center or control window for all of your clips and effects and how they function. We can do a number of things like change our text here, so we can just triple click in here to highlight all of our text and then just type something in. So we say walking through the forest, changing the font. So let's go ahead and do something like that. We can change the size, the tracking, and we can really do a lot of stylistic choices with our text here. And if we wanted to add additional elements like borders or drop shadows, we can go to the shading tab and select what number of elements we want to enable and change. And then to do some positioning to the text, we can go to the layout tab and change our center to move the text. Now another key aspect of the inspector is if we click on any of our clips, we'll see that we have a bunch of different options for how we actually want to control our clips themselves. So we can do things like zooming on the clip, we can change its position, we can change its angle, and then clicking on these icons here will reset those options. You can also do stuff like stabilize your footage. So if we click on this stabilization box and your footage is a little bit shaky, usually the default options are pretty nice, but you can just hit stabilize, it'll analyze the clip and then stabilize it for you, and maybe that'll play back a little bit smoother and eliminate some of those micro jitters, or sometimes it might give you a little weird warbly effect. And if that's the case, you can just change the mode or some of these options. Like if we change the similarity, you can just restabilize it and see if that plays back any better. So a lot of really fun things that you can do in the Inspector. It's a very, very powerful tool that you have at your disposal, and it can be especially helpful for working with audio too. So if we select our audio track and maybe it's a little loud, we can select our audio track going to the Inspector, and it should automatically take us to the audio page. So we can do things like adjusting the volume, what side you want it to play on, as well as some additional audio effects like pitch changing or EQing. And the last final touch I'm going to add is if we go to our text here, instead of adding a transition to make it fade off, you'll notice that we have these little handles here. These are basically little fade handles, so I can automatically fade out the clip by just clicking and dragging this over. So instead of this text cutting off immediately, it can just fade off as it plays. And I think that looks quite nice. And then once we're actually done with our video, we want to send it out to export. We can just hit this quick export box up here. It'll give us a number of presets. If you're going to a specific platform like YouTube, you can have it automatically upload. If you're not currently connected to a platform, you can just hit it and there will be a sign in option for it, so you can connect your platform and upload it to it directly. Or you could just export at H.264, H.265 master and hit export, specify where you want it to go, and then hit save. And that'll render your video out. And then once you're done, you have your completed video. And that was your first edit. And that was the intro to Resolve in 15 minutes. If you'd like some more DaVinci Resolve content, please leave a comment down below. We also have more videos on the channel, as well as my personal channel, where I also include a crash course that features every single page in Resolve. I was going to end this with a bad Resolve Your Problems pun, but I had to trim it out.